Hey, Talking Cars fans. The podcast will soon celebrate its 300th episode, and we want you to be a part of that milestone. So much has changed in the automotive landscape since we first started recording the show back in 2013, nearly 8 years ago. So we want to hear from you. What do you think the biggest changes in the auto industry will be in the next 8 years? Text or email your videos to talkingcars@icloud.com and let us know your predictions for what you think we'll be talking about on Talking Cars in 2029. The best submissions will be featured on episode 300. Again, that's talkingcars@icloud.com for your video submissions. Thanks for watching, thanks for listening, and enjoy the show.
This week, we give our first impressions of the 2021 Ford Bronco Sport, discuss the recently announced Chevrolet Bolt EUV, and what is the strangest wildlife we've ever encountered at our test track. Next on Talking Cars. Hi, everybody. Welcome to another episode. I'm Mike Monticello.
I'm Ryan Pizlikowski.
I'm Gabe Shenhar.
So we're going to start off this week's episode talking about some new cars and, shocking news alert, they're electric vehicles. This week, we're going to talk about the refreshed 2022 Chevrolet Bolt and the all-new Bolt EUV. So, Gabe, I'm going to throw it right to you. You're one of our electric car experts. Tell us what's going on with, you know, the refresh of the Bolt and what the heck exactly is an EUV.
So it's pretty typical for any car, electric or not, to get a mid-life refresh. And the Bolt is getting its due, and it'll get some nip and tuck cosmetically and new infotainment system. We hope the seats will get better because that was one of our main gripes with the original Bolt when we tested in 2017. The EUV is another variant. It's supposed to be a little bit of an SUV-ish kind of thing with slightly more room. And slightly taller, roof rails, all the things that make you think it's an SUV, but it's not going to have all-wheel drive. And you know, we think that customers expect at least the availability of an all-wheel drive with an SUV, and that is a bit unfortunate. We think it's a missed opportunity on GM's part, given customer expectations and given the competition. The upcoming Volkswagen ID.4 and the Nissan Ariya are going to have all-wheel drive options. So that's too bad.
Gabe, what about the announcement that the Bolt EUV is going to get GM's Super Cruise system, you know, which is, this is the hands-free highway active driving assistance system that, you know, CR and our evaluations has rated higher than all the other ones. I mean, that's a pretty big deal that this is going to be the first non-Cadillac General Motors product to get this system, isn't it?
You're absolutely right. So we found that Super Cruise is a responsible way of making a car have some autonomous abilities. So GM mapped freeways in the U.S. and Canada, so you can use the system for self-steering and adaptive cruise control and on official highways, but not have it in any other scenario, which we think is irresponsible. In addition, it also has a driver monitor system, making sure that the driver's eyes are always on the road and you're engaged. Because just having a sensor on the steering wheel and feeling some pressure on the steering wheel is just not enough. You can be completely distracted with your hand on the wheel.
Yeah, that driver monitoring part is a key component of it. Ryan, let's talk about driving range, because the driving range for the regular Bolt is unchanged. Do you think that's maybe, you know, an oversight?
Yeah, so I think there's two oversights here. Gabe mentioned the first one. The EUV is an SUV, so it should be at least offered with all-wheel drive, I think. Families are going to be using that as an SUV. It's a small one, but it's an SUV. They're going to want to use that maybe in the snow, four seasons. I think that's a miss. But 259 miles when the Bolt first came out, that was a few years ago. That was acceptable. That was, you know, that was decent. Today, I think that's a that's a miss. I think they should, there should be some more mileage there. Now the EUV has a 250 mile rated range. That's an SUV. That should have even more, if you ask me. You know, you don't be stopping with your family to charge this thing, or, you know, depending on what you're doing. I think they should have been more range there. But I think the Bolt was a blast to drive when we tested it the first time. It's a zippy little car. It was fun. You know, the front seat gets better, like Gabe mentioned, and the ride maybe gets a little better. Other than that, it was a great little car, and it's affordable, which is a good thing.
It is a fun little car to drive. Another interesting item is that Chevy says that the Bolt, the regular Bolt, is going to be $5,000 cheaper, the 2022 model, than the 2021 model. So, I mean, that's a big thing for consumers.
Yeah, and that reflects the market. Also, it compensates for the fact that GM's $7,500 federal tax incentive has faded out, because the Bolt has been pretty successful for GM. It's been selling the Nissan Leaf, for instance, about 2-to-1. So you're making it easier for customers to pick up a Bolt, even though you're not getting the full $7,500 right. Tax incentive.
It's been reliable, too. That's a good thing. Yeah.
Yeah. According to our member survey, it's been reliable.
And Gabe, will we be buying both the refreshed Bolt and the Bolt EUV when they go on sale this summer, or just the EUV?
We'll definitely buy the EUV. We'll have to see the regular Bolt, and perhaps we can just make some updates with the new infotainment system and interior stuff to update the road test. We'll have to see.
Okay. All right. Well, we have a full preview story on both of these Bolts on consumerreports.org, so please go check that out. Let's move on to the next segment, which is This Week at the Test Track. And this week, we're going to be talking about the 2021 Ford Bronco Sport. These are our first driving impressions of it. And, you know, we were lucky to, you know, we rented a Badlands version from Ford, and we also have bought our own Outer Banks model for our test program. So we're going to be able to talk about both of those and how they're a little different. Just a little background for those of you that don't know what the Bronco Sport is. It's a Ford Escape-based vehicle. But Ford says it has an eye toward being more adventurous off-road. It has more ground clearance, shorter front and rear overhangs, a more serious four-wheel drive system than the Escape. There's two engines. There's a 181 horsepower turbo three-cylinder and a 245 horsepower turbo four-cylinder. Both come with an eight-speed automatic. Four-wheel drive does come standard. Our kind of more mainstream Outer Banks version that we bought cost $33,655. That is with the turbo three-cylinder. And the Badlands version that we rented from Ford has the four-cylinder turbo, and that one costs $36,340. There might be some confusion about the Bronco and the Bronco Sport, but Ford's even, you know, the Bronco's coming later. The Bronco Sport, though, even Ford is saying this is a pretty, you know, serious SUV. They say it's an SUV built for the thrill seeker with standard 4x4 and GOAT modes, which stands for goes over any type of terrain. And the Badlands version is the most serious off-road version. And they say that it finds its place at the peak of Bronco Sport capability. And they say it's the pinnacle of off-road performance with metal bash plates and off-road tires and seven standard GOAT modes. Gabe, it you know, that kind of hyperbole kind of lends it to maybe make people think that you can go, you know, truly mud in and you can go rock crawling with this thing. Is it as serious as they're making it sound?
Well, it's important to really stress the difference between the Bronco Sport and the Bronco, and there's so much confusion out there, even among people that are car people that understand cars and follow car news. So the Bronco Sport is, as it's known in the industry, a soft roader. So it's not designed for serious off-roading. And off-roading is kind of like beauty. It's in the eye of the beholder. So whether you're considering boulder climbing or crossing the occasional muddy trail or sand dune are two different things all entirely. So Ford, by claiming that the Badland is the pinnacle of off-road, is just, in my opinion, just inviting trouble. I mean, I can see people buying this thing and getting themselves in trouble and causing a lot of damage. In terms of being able to do some light off-roading, yes, it's more capable than a RAV4 and a Honda CR-V, for sure. It would be actually interesting to compare it to the Subaru Forester with its X mode, which is also one of the better soft rotors in terms of off-road capability.
Yeah, and Ryan, let's talk about the powertrains, because like I said, we did have the ability to compare the three-cylinder and the four-cylinder. What did you think between the two engines?
I actually drove the Badlands first, the rented version, which has a two-liter four-cylinder turbo engine, and I was quite impressed with it. It's got, you know, spunky. The car takes right off, you know, minimal hesitation and merging in traffic. It felt real nice. It was nice and smooth. Getting in our Outer Banks later on, which has a three-cylinder, the 1.5 liter, the power's okay. I thought it was a little low on power at times. Other people didn't feel that way. But the downside to it is it's got a shutter at low RPMs. It doesn't want to, it holds a low RPM a lot of times, and it's kind of lugs the motor, it feels like, but it gives a shutter in the car, which gives the car a lower quality feeling, if you will. Just that shake, it doesn't feel, you know, smooth or refined. And then some of the shifts I thought were just delayed and slow, but maybe that's due to the power, the lack of power there. It still moves right along. It's not a bad thing, but I thought the 2 liter was a better route, engine wise.
The 2 liter definitely made it more fun because of the, you know, had plenty of power, and like you said, that low RPM when it's a little hesitant to downshift, and then it's lugging at around 1500 RPM, and that vibration is a little annoying. Gabe, could we have gotten the bigger engine in our Outer Banks model?
No, because the bigger engine, the 2 liter turbo, is only available in the Badlands and in the first edition, and all other trims get the 1.5 liter turbo 3-cylinder, which is going to account for about 85% of the mix. Now, I think the 1.5 is sufficient. I mean, other than the shutter that Ryan mentioned, it has enough oomph for what you need. And I think driving the Outer Banks, I found it more enjoyable than the Badlands, because it handles, rides, steers better. It feels more solid, more settled on the road.
Well, I was just going to say that I found similar thing that as far as look, let's be realistic. Most of us are going to be on the road most of the time. And for that sense, and also with the fact that the Badlands isn't as serious of an off-roader as Ford may want to make it seem, the reality is the Outer Banks, the way it's configured, is better, probably going to be better for most people for their daily driving. I will say, though, I did take the Badlands on some of our rougher dirt roads around our Colchester area, and it was really fun. And it, you know, the suspension is so good, especially with those, you know, really meaty off-road tires that it has. It soaked up like potholes that would have in a car, or even a mild SUV would have, you know, been much more serious inside the cabin. This thing just sailed over them. So, Ryan, let's get into the interior. Let's talk about like seats and things like that. What did you find? How did you find the comfort inside these two vehicles?
So I'm going to harp on a seat again, I guess. The front seat was really the only issue I had inside of this car. The rest of the cabin's quite awesome. I mean, there's, you know, just neat stitching and the Bronco on the back of the seat. And, you know, it's a nice cabin. But the seat was a deal breaker for me. I felt like I was sitting on the seat, not in it. And there wasn't support, at least the bottom cushion. The back seat back was okay for me, but the bottom cushion was not supporting me. It also, the adjustment, it doesn't, the front edge of the seat doesn't adjust. So like, if this is a seat, this, you can't do that with the seat.
With the bottom cushion.
You have to pick up the whole seat, and then you have to recline. You get in this weird position to get really comfortable, depending on, you know, your body shape. So for me, it didn't really work that well, but the bottom cushion was driving me nuts. It didn't have enough thigh support. Other than that, it's roomy in there. The driving position is decent. You know, assuming you can get the seat the way you want it. You know, it's a fun car to look at. The styling's there.
The some of those rugged touches inside the interior are actually pretty cool.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, looking at it from the outside or from the inside, I can't see anyone who's not going to have a big smile on their face. I mean, the seat, the brown leather, the images of the Bronco in the infotainment system when you just start the car, and some details like pockets and the zippered pockets and the floodlights and the tailgate, everything is really thought out to be a nice road trip kind of car, and or a camping kind of car. So it's really fun.
Yeah. And so we do have a first drive up on the Bronco Sport, and we are going to be buying, you know, a full-size Bronco as well, or that's the not really a full-size, but the larger Bronco. So go to consumerreports.org, check out the first drive on the Bronco Sport. It's going through our test program right now, so we'll have full road test results on it soon. And as soon as we get the Bronco in, we're going to talk about that. Before we move on, I just want to talk real quick about the Talking Cars donation program. For those of you that might not know, Consumer Reports is a nonprofit organization. So all the work we do is funded by memberships and by donations. So any amount of money you can give helps us continue to do the work that we do, including putting on this Talking Cars podcast for you guys. So you can find more info at cr.org/givetalkingcars. And now let's move on to audience questions. So as always, don't forget to send those questions, comments, 30-second video clips to talkingcars@icloud.com. And wouldn't you know it, this week we have a video question from Malik. So let's see what he has to say.
Hey, CR. Recently I was online and I saw the reliability on my 2017 launcher was below average. I've had the coil pack issue twice, which involved 6 coil packs being changed. And now I'm developing some kind of suspension noise. And so every once in a while, my car just kind of putters and doesn't really like to go whenever I ask power of it. Is this something I need to be really concerned about as far as reliability goes? Do I need to start looking for another car, or should I just keep it? Please let me know. I'm really lost for words.
All right, Ryan, what do you think? Is it time for him to start looking for another car?
So this is a tough situation to be in, and I'm sorry that he's dealing with this, but another car is a lot more money, and you know there is a certain point with any car you have to cut your losses and move on. But I think in this situation, your best bet is to keep fixing it. You know, you're getting close, hopefully, with you know straightening out those issues. The other thing is I would get another opinion or another mechanic to take a look. You know, no offense to this mechanic, but maybe there's, you know, another set of eyes is always a good thing. But it's a tough call because, you are spending more money, but, you know, you have the vehicle, you have the expensive part. You know, cars break no matter what. The next car, if you bought another car, that could have issues too.
Gabe, what do you think? Buy a new car or keep fixing this one?
Well, he should be aware that if he comes back to the same place for the same repair, then he shouldn't be charged for it. There should be the shop has to stand behind its repair. Yeah, I mean, it's hard to tell him what to do. I mean, it all depends, of course, like Ryan said. I mean, fixing a car every now and then, it's a couple of $100 versus buying a new car. That's a matter of shelling another $20,000 or $30,000 or being committed to monthly payments of $300 a month or so. So it's a very individual choice. It's all a matter of how much hassle, how much headache you can take until you say, okay, it's time to move on here.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we certainly wish you luck with your decision there as to what you're going to do. Let's move on to our next question. This one comes from Joel. And Joel says, I would have thought all-weather tires would have become very popular over the years, but they seem to remain a small niche player in the all-season category. Why is that? Ideally, I would like to replace my stock tires on my new 2021 Toyota Highlander all-wheel drive. In your opinion, is it a good idea to go with all-weather tires in the Northeast? All right, Ryan. Well, we live here in the Northeast, so I guess a couple questions. Is it a good idea to go with all-weather tires, and why haven't they become more popular?
So it's a great question. You know, the all-weather segment is actually fairly new here in the U.S. You know, you would think they'd be more popular, but if you know, it takes time for this stuff to catch on. The other part of that is there's confusion. You know, the average person might see the word all-weather next to all-season and think it's just a different way of saying all-season. It's not a, you know, what's the difference? But there is a difference. And an all-season tire will have a M&S on the sidewall, mud and snow. All that is referring to is the tread has a certain geometry that gives it that symbol. It has to meet a certain, void in geometry. A winter tire, a snow tire, will have a 3-peak mountain snowflake symbol on it, which means it has to pass a physical test of traction and snow traction. An all-weather tire carries that same symbol, but it's can be used as an all-season tire year round. You know, winter tires you take off in the spring, and you know for the summer you don't want to run them because they're a very soft compound. Now you might think, oh, this is the do everything perfect tire. Yes and no. Some of these tires don't stop or handle as well as a true regular all-season in those the other three months of the cleared roads, and they don't quite have the grip of a winter tire. It's just another slice of the pie, if you will, in between all season and winter tires in terms of winter grip. And some of them don't even wear as well as an all season tire. So, you know, to answer his question, depending on where you live, if you live in northern Maine or Vermont and you're driving snow a lot, I would recommend a real winter tire, like a true dedicated winter tire. Take it off in the spring, put on an all season tire, so you have the maximum, grip with an all season on dry on wet asphalt. But if you live somewhere a little bit further south and you get snow here and there and you do need to drive in it and you don't want to change, the winter tire changeover, an all-weather tire makes sense. But you got to kind of weigh out what you're dealing with. Nowadays, people sometimes don't even need to drive in the snow because we're all working at home anyway. So, you got to weigh that out.
Right. Okay. Well, that's some good advice, and proves again that there is no one perfect tire that's going to do everything, but you got to, again, weigh your options, weigh the weather, your climate and possibly in Connecticut, maybe an all weather could actually work pretty well. So let's move on to our next question. This one comes from Jeremy. Jeremy says, I am very excited about the upcoming three-wheeled BEVs, which are battery electric vehicles, like the Arcimoto and Aptera. They appear to blur the line between motorcycle and car and perhaps are an entirely new category. Both companies appear to treat them as motorcycles from a regulatory perspective, and I'm curious where they fall within a Consumer Reports rating system. Would your classification affect whether or not they eventually get CR recommended? CR recommended seems a ways off, Gabe, since we haven't even tested them yet, but are these the type of vehicles you could see us testing in the near future?
Well, let's start with the classifications. The classifications are a flexible thing. We can make up any classification we want, so that's not going to determine whether or not we test these. I call these things transportation pods. These are three-wheel vehicles. The Aptera is a very low aerodynamic thing with a lot of solar collectors on the roof. The Arcimoto is also a three-wheeler, but in tandem in seating. Both are two-seaters. The Aptera is side-by-side seating, and the Arcimoto is tandem. And I can see the Arcimoto appropriate for some applications like first responders in very tight spaces and some deliveries in some old cities with that have a lot of little alleys. So whether or not we're going to test them remains to be seen based on the demand out there, based on the interest. And we have ways of gauging readers' interest in these things. So currently, there are no plans to test them.
Okay. But could change down the road. So stay tuned, folks.
Right.
Let's move on to our last question. This one comes from Bob. Bob says, you show lots of videos of test cars driving on your stunningly beautiful track at various seasons. It makes me wonder if wildlife is a hazard at the track while testing. In some views, I notice a cyclone fence, which may keep critters off your property. This is actually a really interesting question. I personally, when I've been at the track later at night doing some work, I've heard coyotes out there running around, but I haven't actually seen any of those. Ryan, you've been working at ATC for a while. Have you had any encounters with wildlife out there?
Yes, for sure. I mean, in the 16 years I've been working there, I've seen, there's deer in there. It's kind of funny bringing up the fence. The fence is ideally keeps, people and animals out, but for the animals, unfortunately, sometimes it works just the opposite. They can get in sometimes during the day. They'll go right through the gate, or there's some areas where a tree might have fallen and they could jump over the fence or whatever, or dig under it. But they get stuck in there. And there's some deer. I've had a bobcat run in front of me. It was far enough away. Yeah, I mean the track is very wide open, so you have a good chance of seeing them. It's not like they can jump out behind a tree while you're buzzing down the straightaway. But the most bizarre animal. Bobcat native around here, deer native. But one day there was an emu is? It looks like an ostrich, like a giant bird. It was on the other side of the fence, trying to get in, and it must have been like one of the neighbors must have had like pet emus or something, and it was on the other side of the fence trying to get in, and I thought that was pretty comical because not a native thing.
That is funny. Gabe, what about you?
Yeah, I've seen some deer that come in and never figure out how to get out, and you know, flocks of wild turkeys and such. But we have a red fox, bushy tail and all. I'm on a first name basis with him. We also have a groundhog that has become a permanent resident and gives a lot of headache to the maintenance people.
Oh, they must love that. Apparently, there were also some very strange looking deer wandering around the property one day when we were shooting our Consumer 101 TV show. But the deer were never seen again. It remains a mystery how they ever got on the property and then were gone. On that note, that's going to do it for this episode. If you want to learn more about the cars and the topics we talked about, you can click on the links in the show notes. Don't forget to send those questions, comments, 30-second video clips to talkingcars@icloud.com. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see y'all next week.